Yay, so great to be with all of you. Anyone else want to say hello? Yes.
We want to say hello basically to our Zoom friends.
Yes. Oh, Jerry and Cindy saying hello to their Zoom friends. It's a mother and child reunion. Yay. So, no, please. It's so wonderful. I know. Melissa's here. The whole family's here. The whole mishpacha. Anyone else want to say hello who hasn't been here for a while? Okay. Yeah, no, later. All right. Well, it's great to see you. Kona, is this Kona's second visit? Kona is here. Can we say Kona's in training?
Yes.
Kona is in training to be a therapy dog with Jill. She's actually passed already.
Yeah.
No, you've passed.
No.
You're certified. No, not Kona,
no.
But you're a pro at this.
No.
Okay. It's exciting. So, okay. So anyone else want to say hello? Well, so glad you're all here. And and online, is there anyone online who's visiting for the first time or wants to say hello? Oh, yes, Mr. Blousing. So great to see you guys. So great to see you guys. You've been in our hearts and minds and prayers, and it's nice to all be together. So was there anyone on Zoom? Or do we have audio from Zoom? Okay. All right. Let us share a sign of peace. Maybe that will help pull us all together here, center us. The kind of peace that reminds us we're sisters and brothers and in this one great family. So the peace of God be with you. And please share peace with the people around you.
How's that? Okay, perfect. Okay, so we're going to go with my name is Denny, and I want to welcome everybody this morning. And since our service today, the theme is seasons, I have two quotes that I wanted to share with everyone. The first one is, he's from Jim Rohn, and he shares that you must take personal responsibility. You cannot change the circumstances, the seasons, or the wind, but you can change yourself. That is something you have charge of. And the second quote is from Henry Cloud. Everything has seasons, and we have to be able to recognize when something's time has passed and to be able to move into the next season. Everything that is alive requires pruning as well, which is a great metaphor for endings. Welcome to worship.
There's a slip of paper. If you'd like to share a prayer of thanks or concern, and then the ushers will pick it up. And if you don't want to do that, we can just take this time for meditation or for silent prayer.
To everything, turn, 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 there is a season, turn, 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 and a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time. A season, turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to build up, a time to break down, a time to dance, a time to mourn,
A time to cast away stones, a time to gather stones together. Do everything turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven. A time of love, a time of hate, a time of war, a time of peace. A time you may embrace, a time to refrain from embracing. To everything turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to gain, a time to lose, a time to rend, a time to sow. A time of love, a time of hate, a time of peace. I swear it's not too late. To everything turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven. To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And every purpose under heaven.
Good morning, everyone. The song that you just heard, Turn, 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 we all know that was popular from the 60s, but believe it or not, that was not invented in, written in the 60s. That's from the Bible. And I'm going to be reading the scripture to you this morning. It's from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. There are 13 verses I'd like to share. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what has been planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love, yes, and a time to hate. A time for war and time for peace. What gain have the workers for their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into the minds, yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. This ends the reading of God's word. Thanks be to God.
That was great. Thank you. Will you please join me in a prayer for illumination? Beloved, we give thanks for this day, for this time and this place. We give thanks for reunions and friends coming home. We give thanks for friendships and new ships and finding each other and finding that spark of your divine image like that in everyone we meet. And so we pray, God, be with us. Help us to squeal with delight. Help us to see the joy of just seeing each other. Help us to lay down whatever is burdening us, whatever is distracting us from yesterday or tomorrow, and let us just be here now. And we pray, let your spirit sweep over us. Remind us. Help us to hear your word and take the words spoken here and make them your word for us. In your many holy names we pray, amen. Today, as Marty was saying, has to be one of the all-time favorite scripture verses, or at least certainly the most famous. After Pete Seeger set those words to music and added the refrain, turn, 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 and the folk rock group runs, but this song then became a staple of campfires and sing-alongs and certainly worship services. Courting hit number one on the Billboard Hot 100. And I don't think too many biblical verses can make that same claim. Though, in researching this, I did learn, you might be surprised as I was, that Carole King's song, Where You Lead, Where You Lead, I Will Follow, is based on the book of Ruth. Where you lead, I will follow anywhere that you tell me to. Who knew? Ecclesiastes is a Latin transliteration of the Greek translation of the Hebrew name Koheleth. And Koheleth is a pseudonym for the author of this book. It was traditionally believed that King Solomon had written this book, but modern scholarship pretty much refutes that idea. It's commonly dated to around 250 years before the time of Jesus and comes from a part of the Bible known as wisdom literature, which includes books like Job, Proverbs, and the Song of Songs, also known as the Song of Solomon. For those who don't like the season of ancient biblical learning, it will come to an end, like all things. It's a bit more pedestrian and experiential in understanding life and the world. It doesn't make the usual case for understanding the nature and the characteristics of God. Some of it is practical advice, perhaps akin to what a first century reader might have found in the self-help section of their local papyrus store. But there's a lot of cynicism and even despair in this book. Let's just say the author seems to be short on any joie de vivre, which Google tells me I've been mispronouncing since I discovered the phrase as a teenager, and it inspired me to learn a French accent. Pete Seeger liked to point out that he only wrote six words for the song. I swear it's not too late. A time for peace, I swear it's not too late. The song was covered by such diverse talent as Judy Collins and Marlene Dietrich in German in a version called Glub, Glub, Glub. Because Google Translate tells me that Glub, Glub is the German word for believe. And that works. Believe, believe, believe. But if you're inspired to visit YouTube, after today's gathering and all this wonderful information, you must check out Marlene Dietrich singing Surrey with the Fringe on Top from Oklahoma. It too is in German, and you will never look at a Rodgers and Hammerstein play the same again. Now, the words that have been ringing in my ears recently with this scripture in mind, turn, turn, turn. The turning of the seasons. Not because the weather in Sausalito turns much. From what I can recollect, we're still in the season we were in 10 years ago when I arrived. And I'm not really sure what to call that season except pretty sweet. Though Koheleth, Ecclesiastes, lays out the seasons side by side, the truth is these seasons are happening all the time, simultaneously, somewhere in some part of the world. While some of us enjoy peace, others suffer in war. While some are breaking down, others are building up, and so on. And these contradicting seasons can even exist simultaneously in ourselves. We may be busy loving some folks and busy hating others, all in the same heart at the same time. And when I say that we can be loving and hating the same person simultaneously, you know what I mean? Thank you. I take yeah as an amen. So these beautiful words and that groovy melody seduce us into an easy acceptance of the author's basic concept that there's a time for everything. I always wondered if there's a lost book of Koheleth called And a Place for Everything, early Marie Kondo. But does it make sense for us as people who generally believe that our basic organizing principle should be love and hopefully compassion? Should we, ever hopeful as we are, ever say there is a time to tear down? Should we ever say there's a time to hate, a time for war? Of course, we could make a theological argument that it's the kind of war the Apostle Paul spoke of when he wrote to the Ephesians. He said, "Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth and shaving, put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the word of the Spirit, which is the word of God." Now that's some pretty heavy war rhetoric for a man who's spreading the gospel of peace. And he's really working that metaphor. And too often, these kind of metaphors can be misshapen and misappropriated to represent actual war of flesh and blood. But given the rest of Koheleth's book, he is most likely just reflecting on the human condition, which for most of us is an uneven mix of good and bad, of beginnings and endings, of joy and of sorrow. But not all seasons are good or bad. And seasons can be a useful metaphor as we move through life. And hey, next week is Labor Day, right? It's the official or the unofficial end of summer. When I was growing up, that was a really sad time. Even though my brother and I had been nagging my mom about how bored we were by the end of August, when we could sense the seasons starting to turn, we were filled with an agonizing feeling that our days of endless playing and TV watching and freedom were about to fade away. And of course, what was coming around the bend was the season of school. I'm glad I had it. Didn't feel that much at the time. Now, I remember a cartoon that captured a side of this season turning, this particular summer season turning. They had a family walking into a store with a big banner, back to school sale. And the kids were sad and angry and had to be dragged into the store. And the parents, they were bright-eyed and cheerful and smiling ear to ear, practically running into the store like, "Oh my gosh, this is so great." And the kids are like whining behind them. You know, we don't all share the same favorite season, be it spring, summer, fall, or winter, or be it the seasons of childhood, high school, your 20s, middle age, the season of senior discounts. Some seasons announce themselves, in like a lion and out like a lamb. The first big snowstorm of the season, if you grew up in the East Coast or in the Midwest, you know what that means. Some seasons quietly enter and you don't even know you've turned into them until you just open your eyes and there you are. We had a lovely wedding here yesterday, and the bride, when I was getting to know the couple, she said she just realized one day that she couldn't imagine not having her boyfriend in her life. And that's when she realized he was the one. There are seasons in friendship, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. There are seasons in love, a time to keep silence and a time to speak. There are seasons in parenting, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. There are seasons in our very existence, a time to be born, a time to die. And some seasons we can't wait for, and some seasons we just don't want. This week, though, these last 2 weeks, really, I've been noticing these seasons. My 16-year-old started their junior year of high school last week. And in addition to noticing the seasons, I've become more aware of how we live with seasons. Now, I just don't know if any of you are native Californians, if you can really understand living in the seasonal climate, you know, where, you know, I lived in New York and Pittsburgh and Chicago, the ebb and flow of nature, the signals and the cues. There are things you look forward to, and it's like you're being reunited with an old friend and you're just so excited. It feels so good. And then there are things you can't stand and you gird yourself for what's coming. If you drive, you put on snow tires or chains, or you put kitty litter in the trunk. You might pull out sheets of plastic to insulate your old window frames like you do in New York City, or dig out your big boots and your gloves and your hats, retrieve your big North Face puffy coat, and when you grab it and it spews feathers, you remember, oh yeah, there's that hole in the shell, I gotta fix that. And you think just how much you hate freezing cold winters and all that snow and your nose running and your eyes freezing. And you swear to yourself, I'm going to move to California next year. But then, just when you're ready to pack it all up, just when you can't take one more day, just when you're sick of that freezing cold and you don't want to even get out of bed, spring awakens. And you think, I love this place. You see, this is what I've been thinking about as seasons turn. The trick to seasonal living, I realize, is learning how to dress for it, how to prepare your home, your car, your yard, yourself. Some seasons are all about shedding. You need to let go of things. You need to lighten up. You need to go light. The sun is warm. Some seasons require bundling up, sharing delicious soups with close friends, or huddled around the kitchen table. Sometimes we don't have exactly what we need. We need to find what we need and prepare for it. I remember one year, my sister and I took my grandmother, my 85-year-old grandmother, to the beach. She wasn't really a regular beach goer in St. Louis, Missouri, or Missouri. So she didn't really have summer clothes. So she wore like her dress and her little pearl necklace, my Ray-Bans. And, you know, we just got her enough of the way in to sit in a folding chair. And she looked like, I don't know, she should have been a member of the Talking Heads. But she did really well. So sometimes we have to gather things around us for the coming season. You know, some seasons in our lives require us to gather each other around. We need to bring our friends close in. Some seasons in our lives bring a time to say goodbye. Time to say goodbye to a way of living, to a place, to things. some seasons in our lives are born of mourning, the loss of something, as we come into something new. Because no goodbye is goodbye. There is always something we're going to. A new season with new things we'll love, with new blessings to greet us that we might not know yet, we might not see, we might not understand, but they come. Even death is not a goodbye. As a life everlasting greets us, we see that the cycle of life speaks to everything and brings it back. Don't try to figure it out. Don't wonder what it's like. It just is. The trick to living in harmony with all the seasons of our lives is to be dressed for the weather and to think about what it is I really need to take with me and what it is that was last season's accoutrement. There's just one thing to remember, and that is, I think for most of us, even in the painful birth of a new season, there is one season that runs through all the seasons. And that's the season of love. Only love. No counterpart. Pure love. And I pray, let us all turn, turn, turn in the season of love. Will you please pray with me?
All right.
Beloved God, sometimes the season is long and the nights are dark, and it's hard to remember the spring. And so we pray, help us to open our eyes to be able to see the budding flower. Help us to mourn fully so that we can embrace fully where we go next, where you're calling us. And help us to remember whatever season we're in, you have sent us each other for company in those seasons. Help us not just to share the good season, but the dark one as well. Because you sent us each other for year-round loving. And we pray you help us do that and embrace that and share that and show that. Amen. As is our custom, we have the dialogue. We have an opportunity to... You have an opportunity to join in this discussion about what we're thinking about. So I want to say, if you're on Zoom, you know how it works. You just have to unmute yourself and jump in there. And I think that's how we'll hear you. And maybe Robin will alert us. Carson will alert us. And if you're here, just raise your hand in the sanctuary. And you can take a moment just to catch your breath and see lots of good people here. Yeah.
Paul?
Yeah, it sounded good.
Okay. Thank you for the beautiful sermon this morning. I, as a child of the 60s, and now I'm a child in my 70s, I love the references of turn, turn, turn. It really stuck out as someone that always has to figure it out. Don't really have to try to figure it out, because it comes. And the sharing thing that you mentioned in your prayer just now really hit home. Thank you for that that feeling.
Thank you, Grover. Let me see. Grover, Robin Sinclair says, thank you, Grover. Very nice.
Good morning. This is Keith.
I think that as we talk about seasons and change, I I see this in my own life right now, that we all look at those changes differently and we all handle them differently, because change can be really hard. And just remembering that we all have our ways of dealing with change, accepting it or working through it, is really important. And to remember to have empathy for each other as we go through those changes together.
Thanks, Denny. Thank you. I think, did I hear someone on Zoom?
Yes, it's Geeta. Good morning.
Hi, Geeta.
So, yeah, Denny, that's lovely. And I'm reading a book called Bittersweet by Susan Cain. And it's wonderful, because I find myself dealing with the relentless season of optimism and happiness. And so, you know, in thinking about, we think about typically like, oh, the darkness, the winter, the long nights, that's fine for me. It's sometimes more difficult to acknowledge that I'm sad or I can't carry everything. So, Denny, I really love that it applies to all of us. I have to remember it too, empathy for whatever people are going through. And it may annoy me, the relentless sunshine, but I'll be able to turn to a different season. Thank you.
Can we, Sterling and then Jackie?
I think it's important to remember that while we resist change, that there are blessings and gifts on the other side that we have no clue exists until they bring a smile or a warm feeling to our hearts. Thank you.
I'm here reflecting on my older grandson going to kindergarten, which is a really big change and transition. And it brings me back to when I was that age and how I loved my neighborhood and my friends so much, I didn't even let my mom walk me to school on the first day.
That's great. I reflect on somehow my daughter started her junior year in high school, and about 2 years ago, she was in kindergarten. And I'm like, I don't know how that happened. Well, shall we pray together? Oh, sorry. Oh, Don.
Well, nothing enlightening, but you mentioned holes in your down, which means you're too young to know everything we wore in winter smelled like mothballs.
Yeah. Before we pray, is there any more, Jim, do you have anything you want to add?
One second, there you go.
Okay, thank you. Well, it's wonderful to be here this Sunday. It's kind of traditional for us, because it's those of you who've been in this church for a while, you remember. You know, and tradition is, well, when you get to be my age, you have a lot of traditions, and you have so many you forget about which ones there are. But, but I do remember the one that Nancy used to help me with, and it was because tomorrow, Monday, the 29th of August, will be our 69th wedding anniversary.
Wow. Woo!
And at that point, I would sit down and Nancy would stand up and say, 37 of the happiest years of my life.
Well, Jim, you know, I hope you'll send our love and congratulations to Nancy, and we're really hoping this is a good year. 38. Oh, thank you, choir. Thank you, quintet. Will you please pray with me? Beloved God, we thank you for time together, and we thank you for time to gather our thoughts, to gather our hearts, to gather our minds. Whatever it is we do here, we're glad we get to do it together. And so we take time to lift up some of the prayer, some of the names in our hearts and on our minds, and were collected by Allison from Zoom and from the sanctuary. Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
We have thanks for Kevin and Jenna and Gavin and Tony and Kona and family and those, and our wonderful church community. We ask prayers for the Sutter family as they relocate and the sale of their home in Windsor, Chris Christie and his decision about knee surgery, Nancy, recovery from diverticulitis, Justin, who's battling cancer, Penny and an upcoming surgery, peace and safe travels, recover from illness, Sully and Austin, who is 27 weeks premature. Some names: Jim, Ann, Riley, Fred, Maria, Steve, Charlie, John, Jetson, Joey, Jack, Jake, Leo, Marianne, Ed, Rowan, Nancy, Bob, Kira, Kyle, Zaria, Louise, Russ, Dave, Diane, Judy, Cindy, Matt, Chris, Barbara, and Todd. Please, Lord, a special touch for all our brothers and sisters in the Ukraine and all those who are suffering today.
We pray, God, for Ann Mahoney, that she'll get to come home soon. We pray for Sam Mowry and his upcoming surgery this week. We pray for all those who might be struggling with an illness or a challenge that we don't know about, but people whom we love and care about, we want them to be well and healed. We pray, God, for the people the world round whose names we'll never know, but whose lives are suffering every day, who are hungry, houseless, poor, imprisoned. We pray, God, that everything we do, we might somehow bring some peace, some cure, some healing in this world. And we lift up to you now prayers that have no words but sit in our hearts as we take time together to pray in silence. O God, hear our prayers and hear us as we pray the words Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Denny, may I ask, would you guys take the offering? Now is our time for offering on Zoom. Thank you so much, those of you who use Givelify, and thanks to everyone who sends in a check or just helps support our ministry. Please rise. Praise God. Give us, we would use in every way we can to help bring a foretaste of your kingdom to come, where love is every season and friends are all around. Amen. Amen. You can just put that over there. And before the quintet blesses us in our worship, one big announcement I just want to, like, if you haven't seen it on the back of the order of service, but Aaron Dottie's book is going on Kindle on Thursday, and there's a big effort to get everyone to buy it. It's 99 cents, and you know, if you get a lot of people to buy it on the same day, you can bump her up to number one. So if you have a Kindle, I don't know if you can buy it even if you don't have a Kindle. I don't think you can. But Aaron Dottie's book on Thursday. And choir? Oh. Thank you so much. You guys brought such beautiful music to us today. I invite us to hang out in front of the church or hang out in the patio. We'll be coming back to fellowship snacking in a few weeks. But before then, let us snack on the good spirits of each other, remembering that life is short and we haven't much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey the way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. Remember always that the love of God and the grace of our brother Christ and the sustaining breath of the Holy Spirit is with us now and forevermore. And wherever you go, wherever we go, let us go in peace and let the people say,
Amen.
Thank you. Amen. Amen.
Thanks, guys.
Open to breakout rooms, fellowship, friendship rooms. Thank you all for being here today. If you want to move rooms, or just hang out here with me, more than welcome. Have a great Sunday, everyone.